The following program is brought to you by Total Theater Online. The views expressed do not necessarily represent those of the staff or management of WGBB. You're listening to the station that serves your community, 1240 WGBB. And now it's time for Dave's Gone By with David Lefkowitz.
Good evening, everybody. Welcome to Dave's Gone By, 90 minutes of talk radio, music, and comedy brought to you by Total Theater and Performing Arts Insider and served up to you like Thanksgiving leftovers by me, Dave Lefkowitz, radio personality, journalist, songwriter, and theater critic. Dave's Gone By has been airing on this radio station, WGBB AM 1240 Freeport, and live streaming on the web at am1240wgbb.com since October 2002. This is our 54th episode, hence the title of this one, 54 Studio. Takes the name of the Disco Palace backwards, since you're unlikely to hear any disco on this program. Actually, last week, the Thanksgiving show, we played an Ian Dury track, Reasons to be Cheerful, that did hark back to the disco era, but Dury was more a creature of the post-punk new wave period than the glitterball years, so we'll let that slide. But we do play all kinds of music on this program, and comedy, and interviews, and sketches, and whatever else seems appropriate at the time. Or inappropriate. I'm no Martha Stewart. There's no discrimination here based on silly things like taste and decorum. I'm here to have fun. I'm here to share 90 minutes of smart talk, silly talk, special talk, and music. And I think we cover all the bases tonight. You want music and enrichment? Stick around for our Dave's Gone Cultural segment this week devoted to the Broadway revival of Wonderful Town. You want comedy? We got that in a special birthday segment where we pay tribute to 68-year-old Woody Allen. I know he's not exactly the most politically correct celebrity out there at the moment, but I think too many people have forgotten or conveniently disregard just how much this man has contributed to American humor, to film, to the mystique of New York City, to the allure of teenage Korean girls whose hearts belong to daddy. No, but seriously. And unseriously, we've got some classic Woody Allen routines coming up in the next half hour, plus a special secret recording of Woody that he probably wishes never saw the light of day. Cool stuff, but that's just the first part of the show. We also have The News Gone By, our weekly look at world events from a sarcastic, cynical, Woody Allen-ish perspective. And this is one of the best News Gone Bys ever. It's huge and filled with amazing stories about everyone from Wesley Clark, Neil Bush, Harvey Fierstein, Glenn Campbell, and Indian guru Prahlad Jani, who makes David Blaine look like Star Jones. We'll have stories about hookers, cannibals, cable TV, the Klan, guns, drugs, farts, shoplifters, drunk drivers, and the arrival of the Orgasmatron. And I don't mean the one in Sleeper. Ladies and gentlemen, if you are in your car, or at your office, or on your home computer, trust me, you're going to want to keep your dial exactly where it is until 8 o'clock. If you have children listening, okay, perhaps a little caution is in order. This program is rated DGB-13 for content that is in no way obscene or offensive or FCC-21, but we will be talking about folks like Michael Jackson, Woody Allen, Bill Clinton, and the mere mention of these names has been known to deflower young teenagers by proxy. So, listeners, beware. And be aware that Dave's Gone By exists through your contributions and the support of our sponsors. We'll hear from two of them, and then be right back to begin our Woody Allen birthday tribute just 60 seconds from now! Welcome back to Dave's Gone By on this December 1st, 2003. A lot of famous people, creative people, having a birthday today. Bette Midler, Richard Pryor, John Densmore of The Doors, Lou Rawls, Mary Martin, and Cyril Richard, both gone, both appearing in that famous 1960 TV version of Peter Pan, Mary as Peter, Cyril as the dastardly Captain Hook. But the most important birthday for me, one of the most iconic influences on my sense of humor, my career in the arts, my appreciation of theater and movies, born today, December 1st, 1935, Woody Allen. Allen, of course, was his real first name. He was born Allen Stewart Konigsberg in Brooklyn to Martin and Nettie Konigsberg, who were Orthodox Jews at that point. Money was tight, and Woody's dad had all different kinds of jobs, including a short stint involved in organized crime, of all things. Meanwhile, Woody escaped his rather grim Brooklyn existence at the movies, which was easy to do because he remembers there being 25 different movie houses in walking distance from where he lived. The first movie he saw? Snow White. The first movie he saw that made him want to make a movie? The Black Swan, with a swashbuckling Tyrone Power and a fiery Maureen O'Hara. Just a few years later, Woody was already steeping himself in European art films, which he found more grown up. He also made the grown-up decision when he was 15, long before his career took off, to change his name to Woody Allen. A year later, he was writing jokes for all the TV comedians and got his big break as a writer on Your Show of Shows. Well, the rest of his career is pretty well known by everyone. It started in earnest in 1961 as Woody made it big on the stand-up circuit with material that is absolutely every bit as unique and off-center and funny today as it was then. For example...
Listen to this. I was watching one night the, the Ed Sullivan Show, and Sullivan had on a hypnotist called the Great Rinaldo. And Rinaldo got four guys out of the audience and he hypnotized them. And he said to them, you think you're a fire engine. And I'm home watching and I get drowsy and I fall asleep. And I wake up an hour later, I turn the set off. And suddenly I'm seized with an uncontrollable impulse to dress up in my red flannel underwear. Which I do when I'm looking at myself in the mirror. And suddenly the phone rings. I burst out the front door and start running down Fifth Avenue fast, making a siren noise. At 14th Street, I hit a guy at an intersection who was also wearing red flannel underwear. We decided to work as one truck. We start running down to the village. Suddenly, two guys in red flannel underwear pass us, running uptown. We figure they must know where the fire is. We turn and follow. At 86th Street, a cop flags us down because there's four guys in red flannel underwear running up the street. He says, you're coming down to headquarters, get into the car. And I start giggling hysterically, because this jerk is trying to get a fire engine into a lousy little Chevy. And down at the station house, there's hundreds of guys in red flannel underwear. I should just add, parenthetically, these stories are true. These things actually happened to me. I don't make them up. My life is a series of these crises that came on one night. Some months ago, and I went to the closet in my bedroom, and a moth ate my sport jacket. He was laying on the floor nauseous, you know? It's a yellow and green striped jacket, you know? Little fat moth laying there, groaning, you know? Part of the sleeve hanging out of his mouth. I gave him two plain brown socks. I said, eat one now and eat one in a half hour.
Woody Allen on Dave's Gone By from kind of late in his career as a stand-up comic, August 1968 in San Francisco. By then, he was already getting into the film business. He wrote the comedy What's New Pussycat, and he was so upset at what the studio did to it, he vowed never to write another film he wouldn't also direct. Actually, he'd go back on that promise once or twice. Play It Again, Sam was filmed by Herbert Ross. And he didn't mind acting in other people's films if the pay was good, so he took a cameo role in Casino Royale. That gave him enough money to make What's Up, Tiger Lily, a silly Japanese gangster film Allen dubbed over with an even sillier English translation. Actually, Allen hated that film as much as What's New Pussycat, and he sued to stop its release, but while the case was in court, Tiger Lily opened and got rave reviews, so he left well enough alone and dropped the lawsuit. This also gave him the leverage to direct his first movie, Take the Money and Run, which was actually offered to Jerry Lewis to direct before Woody Allen got his shot. The studio then told Woody he could direct it himself, but he had to keep the budget under $1 million. He did, And the movie kind of shows it, but that only contributes to its breezy, any-gag-for-a-laugh style that still feels refreshing 30 years later. Anyway, after Take the Money took some good money at the box office, United Artists gave Woody carte blanche to do, quote, whatever he wanted to do. And for all the people who thought the serious Woody didn't emerge until Interiors, you might be surprised to learn that his first script after Take the Money and Run was a drama about the jazz era. Well, despite promising Woody free rein, the studio tightened the reins, so they asked him to do another comedy instead. Fair or not, this resulted in Bananas, one of the funniest films of all time, with two of Allen's other movies in the early 70s also making that list, in my opinion, Sleeper and Love and Death. In between, he also directed Everything You Always Wanted to Know About Sex, which is uneven but fun. He also wrote and starred in the aforementioned Play It Again, Sam, on Broadway, and he wrote and directed a half-hour satire for public television that never aired because it made indirect fun of Henry Kissinger at a time when that was too risky politically. It's still never been aired, but it's apparently pretty funny and available at the Museum of Broadcasting, as are a couple of comedy specials he did for network TV. Now, for Woody Allen, 1977 was the watershed year, with Annie Hall winning the Oscar for Best Picture while its director was busy playing clarinet at Michael's Pub. He finally got to make his serious movie in 1978, Interiors, which was basically trying to be Ingmar Bergman in America, and I thought it succeeded in a lot of ways. And a year later, with Manhattan, Allen showed the world he had no problem integrating seriousness and comedy. His film vocabulary had matured, and his scripts were not only witty, but textured. So at that point, he was absolutely on the short list of the best directors in America. And this didn't really change in the 1980s, despite the occasional lousy movie like Stardust Memories or really boring one like Another Woman, because that same decade, he was also making comedies like Zelig, Broadway Danny Rose, Purple Rose of Cairo, Radio Days. Every autumn would bring some new treat, and sometimes you would get a masterpiece like Hannah and Her Sisters, which I think remains his most perfectly satisfying and insightful and humane film. Crimes and Misdemeanors from 1989 was no slouch either, although that one's more cynical and points to some of the sourness you get in Husbands and Wives and Deconstructing Harry. But in the 1980s, Woody Allen was still a reliable brand name, a reason to go to the movies, a reason studios would bankroll a film they knew would not make $80 million, but would likely show a fair profit, all the while contributing to a canon of work unrivaled since Chaplin and Keaton and, in a different genre, Alfred Hitchcock. And it should have continued like that into the 1990s, but something happened. It happened personally, it happened professionally, and justified or not, it continues to hang over his legacy. Now, we'll leave aside the marital stuff for a moment, but we'll come back to it. Critics started getting a little tired of the films themselves. Suddenly, all these people who bitched when Woody wanted to experiment or turn serious now wanted more from him than sweet little comedies he could seemingly churn out in his sleep. Even when he was still with Mia, people thought Alice was kind of slight, and his performance shtick was getting old in Scenes from a Mall, a film he didn't even direct or write. So trying to get the old magic back, he teamed up with Diane Keaton in 1993 for Manhattan Murder Mystery, but that was more annoying than funny, and he took his lumps for trying a musical, Everyone Says I Love You, which starred a host of actors who really weren't singers. But why is it when people and the media think of Woody Allen's more recent output, they forget that throughout the 90s he was still releasing a film a year, and a lot of those films were good and were very well received, and hold up just fine on repeated viewing. Mighty Aphrodite made a star out of Mira Sorvino. Bullets Over Broadway was popular enough to spawn plans for a musical version on Broadway. I mentioned Husbands and Wives and Deconstructing Harry before, which both had dark elements, but that's what gave them their bite. In fact, I would wager that in another 10 or 20 years, Husbands and Wives will be ranked as one of Allen's masterworks. I haven't seen Sweet and Lowdown, which came at the end of the 90s, but many consider it his best film of the 90s. And even the two movies after that, Small Time Crooks and Curse of the Jade Scorpion, they're fun, light, inconsequential, a little dusty if you're looking for contemporary relevance, but certainly worth a nice evening at the VCR or DVD. I haven't seen Hollywood Ending or his last film, Anything Else. You'd probably be hard-pressed to find people who have seen those, but there's a general sense of Woody falling back on some very predictable patterns, plot lines, and punchlines. Not to mention that, okay, it felt a little skeevy seeing his leading ladies get younger and younger. It's one thing to watch him be catnip to Diane Keaton and Andrea Markovici when he was 40. It's another to see him cavorting with Juliette Lewis and Elizabeth Shue when he's old enough to be their grandpappy. Which does bring us to his personal life. Puny, neurotic, whiny. Somehow, this little redhead held tremendous attraction for women, even as time and again he proved a less than gallant mate. His first wife was not Louise Lasser of Mary Hartman, Mary Hartman fame. She was wife number two. He married Harlene Rosen when he was 19, and they were divorced just a couple of years later. One of his most famous jokes as a stand-up comic seemed to come at her expense, the one where he said he read in the papers that his ex-wife had been violated, but knowing her, it probably wasn't a moving violation. One hopes, of course, that the whole joke was fictional, but it would be part of a comedian's penchant to never let empathy get in the way of a good punchline. In 1964, Woody Allen married Louise Lasser on lunch break when he was working on What's Up, Tiger Lily. Lasser told an interviewer at the San Francisco Chronicle they bought a ring in Times Square and, no joke, Woody fainted during the blood test. But Lasser made it clear Allen is not the schlep he plays in the movies. He's actually very decisive, she said. In our relationship, he was the stable one. He really understands a lot about women, unquote. Well, not enough to make that marriage last, but enough at least to realize marriage wasn't for him, for a long time anyway. Diane Keaton always seemed to be his true soulmate. I wish I knew why they didn't work out. And then he played the eligible New York bachelor game for a few years and then settled down in semi-adjoining apartments with Mia Farrow, a fascinating and beautiful actress with a predilection for children that makes Michael Jackson look like W.C. Fields. Well, the rest of that story?
Woody and Mia were lovers. 12 years they had their fun. Mia looked after 11 kids. Woody had his eye on one. Her name was Sun Yi. It's quite complicated, you see. Woody was pushing 60. Sun Yi was just 21. Sun Yi said, Woody, take some pictures of me. Woody said, you bet your buns and whatever you show, don't let your mom know. Mia discovered those photos, called up old Al Dershowitz. Al said, if Woody wants custody, give him all 11 kids. Then let's see him work. They will drive him berserk. Well, Mia, she became furious. Said, Sun Yi, what have you done? Mia took Sun Yi's whole closet of clothes and shredded them one by one. Sun Yi said, be my guest. Woody buys me the best. Now this fall there is a movie. In it, Woody and Mia are wed. Woody meets a real young student and they end up going to bed. What cheap, dirty shots. Where's he getting these plots? Woody and Mia were lovers. And like all lovers, they'd fight. But how many couples have to go to the mat on television every night? Woody and Mia, you know, we got one hell of a show. Look out!
Hello? Who is this? Hi, Dr. Harrison. Who is this? Dr. Harrison, it's me. Oh, no. What is it, Woody? I'm sorry to bother you. I know it's late. 3 o'clock in the morning. Yes, yes, I really need your advice. I'm very upset and depressed and vaguely horny. I can't just wait until tomorrow. No, I have a whole other topic for that, about parental angst and being bombarded by phallic symbols every time I go into Zabar's. All right, Woody, what's the problem? What isn't the problem? It's Sunyi. She's driving me crazy. Crazy in what way? Doc, she wants another baby. Another? You're already raising two toddlers, Bashay and Manzi. I know. I walk around the house trying to think of a new screenplay, but as soon as I get on track, I'll step on a squeaky toy or whatever I was thinking about goes out of my head. Well, Sunyi does most of the work as far as parenting, right? I mean, I don't think you've ever changed a diaper. Once. It was empty. It just looked like it was on backwards, so I put it on the other way, and then it looked even worse, and then I forgot which way was the correct way, so I kept putting it on and taking it off, and Bashay started shrieking, then I started shrieking, and suddenly there was urine everywhere. Well, you can't blame the baby for being nervous. Not hers, mine. All right, so you obviously have some parental anxiety. Have you discussed this with Sunyi? Yes, but she loves being a mother. It's fulfilling some cosmic Shavian uber geisha kind of need. Well, how do you feel about your daughters? Honestly, I could take them or leave them. Really? Yes, I take them when they're 16 and leave them when they're 30. Now, Woody, we've been over this. You have a child-woman fixation, a desire for a companion you can mold in your own image and treat almost like a daughter. Keyword, almost. Yes, but at the same time, you rely on her as a sexual partner and benign mother figure. That's what made Sunyi so attractive. Mia became too wrapped up in her extended family and neglected you. Precisely, it was the neglect and Sunyi's pert little 34 B cups. And now you're afraid to lose her focus just the same way you lost Mia's. It's true. Mia once had a sleepover party at her apartment, 3 dozen children screaming and making noise, so I said, everyone who isn't related, please go home. 2 kids left. It's lucky for them, because if they stayed the night, Mia would have adopted them. Yes, but this isn't about Mia. This is about you and Sunyi and her desire for another baby. Does she want to adopt again, or... Oh, adopt. I'm not saying I couldn't get the job done. I'm an animal in the bedroom. Unfortunately, the animal is a lemming, but... You're saying you're too old? Please, my penis has its own AARP card. That's pretty good, Woody. I know, I'm using it in my next movie, and my next 2 movies after that. Say, how is your latest project going? Oh, you mean Untitled? Yes, Woody. Well, I'm excited by it. We just cast Reese Witherspoon. She plays a 17-year-old math prodigy going to an all-girls boarding school in Paris. Uh-huh. Before she left, she promised to marry the boy next door, a smart, nice boy she grew up with, but not on her level. Who plays the boy? Oh, we have offers out to Elijah Wood and Haley Joel Osment. Go with Wood. Osment whispers too much. You think? Absolutely. Oh, okay, Elijah it is. Anyway, the girl is overwhelmed by Paris. She's too nervous to really experience it, so she spends most of her free time around school, and she develops this complete mad crush on her brilliant calculus teacher, a much older man who takes her under his wing. Let me guess. The older man is funny, cynical, neurotic, self-centered, physically homely, but somehow irresistible to young women. Exactly. And he's being played by Ian McKellen. Oh, wow. Yes, I'm so thrilled we were able to get him. When do you start shooting? Will, I'm still working on the third act of the script. That's where a former championship hockey player, about 70 years old, moves to Paris after his wife dies. And he lives in the same district as Witherspoon, and they're always running into each other at cafes and markets, and she finds herself drawn to him because he's funny, cynical, neurotic, self-centered, handsome, and irresistible to young women. I play him. Retired championship hockey player. Yes, there's a scene set in a roller rink where I use a broomstick to slam a puck through a concession stand. Woody, how are you going to manage that? A lot of close-ups, a lot of cutting, and a lot of Vicodin. Woody, I need to get some sleep. Is there anything... Doc, you still haven't said what I should do about baby thing. You know what to do. You need to sit down with Sun Yi and have a very honest talk with her about how you want to spend the rest of your life. I know. And by the time your two daughters are young teenagers, you'll be 80 years old. Exactly. Do you think they would still date me, though? Hello? Doc? Doc, see you tomorrow, right? Doc?
In summing up, I wish I had some kind of affirmative message to leave you with. I don't. Would you take two negative messages? My mother used to say to me when I was younger, if a strange man comes up to you and offers you candy and wants you to get into the back of his car with him, go.
Happy birthday, Woody Allen, and many happy returns to our movie theaters and to the appreciation you've earned so many times with your work. Back with more of my work on The News Gone By right after this. Welcome back to Dave's Gone By on AM 1240 WGBB Freeport and AM 1240 WGBB.com. It's time for the News Gone By, a look at world and local events of the past week from a dissembling perspective. We begin, as usual, with war news. All things considered, Americans have been pretty blasé about soldiers dying in Iraq. After all, it is a war, and it's not as if we've lost thousands over there. But there was a sense of shock last Sunday about the way two Americans died. The soldiers were riding in a non-military car in Mosul, 215 miles from Baghdad, when they were ambushed. They were stopped at a traffic light when Iraqi gunmen opened fire. The soldiers were not only wounded, but at that point, a dozen Iraqi civilians pulled them out of the car, beat them savagely with bricks and stones, and then bashed their heads in with concrete blocks. Some reports say the men were also stabbed and had their throats cut. Now granted, this is no worse than halftime at a European soccer match, but it's not something we're accustomed to, and it does reverse the old Sally Field thing of, they hate us! They really hate us! Now, Jackie Mason had a good line in his Broadway show that closed yesterday. He said, 6 months ago, President Bush declared that the major fighting in Iraq was over. This is wonderful news. He didn't tell the Iraqis, but for us... No, but that's a valid point. It's a sore spot that more American soldiers have died over there since we won the war than when we were technically fighting it. So we do have to wonder not whether this is another Vietnam, but if things get bad enough, why don't we resume major hostilities? I'll go back to the soccer metaphor. If you're playing a soccer game and you're winning 138-3 at the end of the first half, okay, start of the second half, you take all your offensive and defensive players and you crowd them around the net. No need to keep running around the field risking injuries, bone spurs, twisted ankles, and fights. You just play defense. But now the other team thinks of a zillion ways to get the ball into your net, and they start scoring again and again, sneaking the ball around the sides, taking your players out with hard hits and vicious maneuvers. And you're at a disadvantage because you're the visiting team. They're at home, they know the turf, and the crowd is on their side. So suddenly it's 138-60. And you're still not in danger of losing, but you're starting to get your ass kicked by attrition. What do? You go back out there on offense, and you ram the ball down their throats is what you do. You get that score up as high as you can until you control every inch of that field. Well, the American forces are threatening to do that with raids and searches and all that, and finally some of the fighting back that they did this weekend. But it's helpful to remember, and I wish the generals would remember, that we can start blowing up buildings again and killing hundreds of people instead of a few dozen troublemakers. Will that cost us the Iraqis' goodwill? What goodwill? They're putting our soldiers, pulling them out of cars and splitting their heads like cavemen due to coconuts. Will it put off our allies from helping us over there? Well, Considering their embassies and convoys are already being demolished, I can't imagine it doing any worse harm. So it does bring up the Vietnam parallel in a side way. Not, oh my god, what a human tragedy, or should we have gone there in the first place? That stuff is moot at this point. Now it's a simple question. Either get out or get tougher. Now there's the joke of the two Arab boys at the Islamic kindergarten. One turns to the other and says, what do you want to be when you blow up? One answer, our answer should be, you get to be a casualty, and we get to choose the time, place, and method. Well, meanwhile, President Bush made a secret Thanksgiving Day flight to Iraq to boost the troops' morale and to dispel the notion that the military made a lot of strategic errors in its planning. Unfortunately, the following day, the Air Force made its biggest blunder of all, allowing Bush to fly home and get back in the White House. On the other side of the fence, whatever you think of Democratic challenger Wesley Clark, he knows his Shakespeare. On TV's Face the Nation, Clark blasted President Bush and the Republican Party for using fear of terrorism and 9/11 paranoia as part of their re-election strategy. But he also praised the president, saying, quote, the people love what he represents, a man who's overcome adversity in his life from alcoholism and pulled his marriage back together and moved forward. Ouch! And Brutus was an honorable man. Now, while other Democratic candidates have no trouble criticizing Bush's economic and foreign policies, Georgie Boy's battle with a bottle has been considered off-limits. And it is rather bad taste for Clark to bring it up at this point. Still, it's nothing compared to the compliment Clark gave fellow candidate Howard Dean, saying, Mr. Dean looks lies and corruption and failures of the current administration straight in the face. And that's why he's cross-eyed. By the way, for everyone who thought Bill Clinton was the only president with an embarrassing brother, behold the case of Neil Bush. The current president's sibling is having all sorts of dirty laundry shaken out in divorce proceedings from his wife of 23 years, Sharon. Sharon's lawyers put Bush on the spot about his various consulting jobs, including $2 million from a semiconductor firm in China, even though he admits to knowing absolutely nothing about semiconductors. He also gets $15,000 every 3 months as co-chair of an investment firm, even though he knows nothing about finance. On the personal side, Bush admitted that while still married, he had sex with various women on trips to Thailand and Hong Kong. According to Bush, and this is the straight news, folks, I'm not embellishing, according to Neil Bush, women would simply knock on the door of his hotel room. He let them in, and they had sex. He said he didn't know if they were prostitutes because they never asked for money, and he never paid them. Mr. Bush, you have to admit, said Sharon's lawyer, and this is a quote, it's a pretty remarkable thing for a man just to go to a hotel room door and open it and have a woman standing there and have sex with her. It was very unusual, the president's brother replied. Asked to comment about his brother's testimony, George Bush said, gee, I guess I'm not the luckiest idiot in my family. Speaking of men and their hoes, New York Giants Hall of Famer Lawrence Taylor went on 60 Minutes last night to talk about his career in the NFL, including his substance abuse, steroid use, and hiring hookers. In fact, Taylor admitted to hiring escorts for players on opposing teams the night before a big game. The idea was that the girls would keep the guys up all night and tire them out. Taylor told 60 Minutes he would make sure the girls understood that aspect of the job. He said, quote, every time the guys would start to say, oh, we gotta get some sleep, that's when the party really starts. Although Lawrence Taylor's confessions are shocking, they do explain a lot about the current condition of professional sports. It now becomes apparent that prostitution in this country is not being funded by drugs or money laundering, but by the defensive line of the New York Jets. On the education front, say what you will about Michael Jackson, at least he genuinely likes children. I doubt you could say the same about Jane Fassone, a Brooklyn elementary school teacher who's been on the job perhaps a little too long. According to the Daily News, she was arrested last week for spraying air freshener on a 10-year-old boy with Down syndrome. Witnesses say the boy farted in class, and when he did, the teacher pulled his pants down and sprayed aerosol freshener on his ass. Then she spritzed some of the freshener at his mouth, pushed him up against the wall, and made him stand there for an hour and a half. Fasson was arrested on charges of third-degree assault and endangering a child's welfare. The arrest came as a shock to Fasson's neighbors, who all said she's a nice, church-going woman who's been teaching disabled kids for years. They did say she should have seen trouble coming from the way the boy was dressed. After all, he was wearing a windbreaker. Yay! 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 There goes that comedy bell! Signaling that Dave's gone by bad pun of the week. Every week we make a play on words so stinky, so fart-fetched, that it knocks the wind right out of us. All we can do is hold our collective noses and ring the comedy bell. And if you want that bell to toll for thee, by associating your product, business, or service with this program, now's your chance. The rates are cheap, the method is memorable, the results remarkable. If you think I'm kidding, name an Indian restaurant in Rockville Center. Did you say the Tandoor Grill? And if I ask you, why should you leave off the last I? Did you say because it's Indialicious? My guess is, if you listen to this show regularly, you answered those questions, and maybe you even went to eat at that restaurant, which is one of our fine sponsors. Or if I ask, what's the best place to find out about Broadway, off-Broadway, and cabaret theater, by now you should know by heart that it's Performing Arts Insider magazine. Advertising on Dave's Gone By works on three principles: repetition, humor, and repetition. And it helps us reach thousands of listeners every week with my message and yours. So advertise on this program by sponsoring the Dave's Gone By Bad Pun of the Week. Call 516-295-1511 to find out how. 516-295-1511. You won't find a cheaper or better way to reach so many people, and so many people paying close attention, both on the radio and on the internet. 516-295-1511, or email davesgoneby@aol.com, davesgoneby, no apostrophe, @aol.com, to sponsor the Dave's Gone By Bad Pun of the Week. Don't be good, be ponderful. Try a little kindness, more like try a little slivovitz for him these days. The country music semi-legend, who had seemingly conquered alcohol addiction years ago, seemingly hasn't. Campbell was arrested last Monday in Phoenix on charges of extreme drunken driving after crashing his BMW into a white Toyota sedan. He left the scene of the accident but was followed by a witness and greeted by police when he got to his home. The cops brought him to the police station, where he kneed one of the officers in the thigh. Tests showed he had a blood alcohol level of more than 0.15. That's nearly double the legal limit for drivers. Which also explains why Campbell was by turns belligerent, friendly, combative, and congenial. According to the Associated Press, he started singing while they were processing him. Now, just by sheer coincidence, pure luck, one of the police officers had a tape recorder handy and recorded the incident. And we have that recorded. I downloaded it off the internet. I think it's pretty clear that the singer was inebriated, because it's an old Jimmy Webb song that Campbell made famous, only here he's totally twisted the lyrics around. It's a pretty incriminating performance. Rather sad, actually. So here's Glenn Campbell, live from the county jail, in a Dave's Gone By exclusive, By the Time I Get to Phoenix.
Let go of me, let go of me. By the time I get to Phoenix, I'll be weaving, going 80 miles an hour, maybe more. I'll smash that lame Toyota with my Beamer, if there's damage that's what royalties were for. By the time the police find me, I'll be plastered. I'll ramble on and on and on and on and on just like a kook. I'll kick and fight those law enforcement bastards and fill their breathalyzer up with puke. By the time I get to prison, I'll be sleeping. I'll be dreaming of how big I used to be. My son will pay my bail and he'll be weeping. I'll say, Daddy's gonna fight this, wait and see. This is how most country music comes to be. Let's go home and talk this over, you and me. Or wait, you go. That bar is open until 3.
Welcome back to Dave's Gone By on AM 1240 WGBB Freeport and AM 1240 WGBB.com, live streaming on the web with the news gone by. And we've got so much more news for you. It's been a banger week. Well, the holiday shopping season is upon us, especially in Orange City, Florida, where customers lined up at 3 in the morning outside the Walmart to be the first in the store for the big post-Thanksgiving sale. The siren sounded at 6 a.m., and 41-year-old Patricia Van Lester ran to the electronics section to pick up a DVD player for $29.95. She was not alone, however, and in the melee to get in the store and grab the stuff, she was pushed to the floor and trampled on. Her sister, who was with her, screamed at the other shoppers, "Stop stepping on my sister!" But they just kept walking over her, quote, like a herd of elephants. Paramedics found Van Lester unconscious on top of a DVD player, I'm reading this verbatim from the Associated Press, and she was surrounded by shoppers seemingly oblivious to her. Van Lester apparently had a seizure after she was knocked down. She's being hospitalized and treated. She's all black and blue. A Walmart spokesperson said she didn't know what caused the stampede. The lucky part was that Van Lester wasn't injured in the second, even bigger stampede a few minutes later. That's when the police came in the back way to investigate, and one of the janitors whispered, "Immigration!" Harvey Fierstein raised some hackles at Macy's department store by appearing on a float. No, he wasn't the float. By appearing on a float in its Thanksgiving Day parade dressed as Mrs. Santa Claus. Now, the day before, Fierstein's op-ed piece appeared in the New York Times, wherein he called for national legalization of same-sex partnerships. Macy's thought this was all inappropriate for such a familial holiday, especially when Fierstein posed the direct question, what if Santa really was gay? It's easy to say, no big deal, but if gay Santa asks your children if they want to ride up and down the North Pole, just say no. Speaking of kids, tragic news out of Williamsburg, Brooklyn. A school bus was dropping off little Gabriel Illowitz from his day at yeshiva. He gave his mother a hug, but she was distracted for a minute by her other kids. When she looked back, Gabriel was lying flat on the pavement, accidentally run over by the bus while it pulled away. No charges are being filed against the driver. Nearby, a group of young black men stabbed a Hasidic scholar to death, shouting revenge, justice, and get the Jew. Asked why they were so upset about the accident, the leader said, "What accident?" In crime news, a bank robber in Rochester, New York, was turned in by a most unlikely informant, his mom. Photographs of Calvin Walker robbing an HSBC bank showed up on the evening news. His mom saw the pics, confronted him, and then called the police. She said the photos were blurry, and she wasn't 100% sure it was him until he promised to buy her a $30,000 necklace for Mother's Day. She asked him how he could afford it, and he said, "Ma, I told you, I've been Burger King Employee of the Month 2 months in a row." Hey, are you single, gay, and German? If you are, take a tip from Armin Meiweiss. Move. Meiweiss says that there are more than 800 predatory sexual cannibals living in Germany. And he should know, he's one of them. Last year, Meiweiss put his personal ad on a singles website seeking, quote, young, well-built men, age 18 to 30, to slaughter, unquote. Not only did his ad get a lot of hits, he got a date with 43-year-old Bernd Jungen Brandes. Brandes went on videotape and agreed to be murdered by Meiweiss, who gladly complied. The worst part is before he was killed, Brandes allowed Maiweis to cut off his penis. Maiweis then flambéed it, and a la Hannibal, together they both ate Brandes' winky. Asked why he would cook and eat another man's penis, Maiweis said, two reasons. It tastes great going in, and it feels even better going out. More news from the Rhineland. German police arrested a shoplifter who aroused suspicion by waddling through a supermarket with 177 cigarette packets in his trousers. Security spotted him, even though he had three accomplices who shielded him by standing nearby with open newspapers. Asked about the thief, police said they could tell he was desperate by the sheer number of cigarettes in his pants, and they could tell he was Polish by the number of cigarettes that were already lit. Remember a couple of weeks ago, we did a story about an English couple who had to move because they couldn't stand living on their street anymore. They just couldn't take the embarrassment of living on Butthole Road. Well, now there's a whole town in Powell, Wyoming, who are upset about their county road. Back in 1980, the area adopted an alphanumeric road naming system. No big deal for most places, but this town got stuck with County Road 6FU. More than 30 property owners have signed a petition asking for an alternate name. Terry Hinkle, a resident, told the Associated Press, quote, "The name of this road with its obscene overtone has really been a thorn for me. I can assure you there is no other road in the United States that has the name FU." Ah, Mr. Hinkle, not true. Another street has FU written all over it. Of course, it's better known as 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue. Another small town, Geauda Springs, Kansas, is a hick burg of 210 people, a quiet community that doesn't even have its own police force. Maybe that's why they just passed a law requiring households there to have both guns and ammunition. You heard me right. Unlike other places busy trying to institute gun control, Geauda Springs has voted to compel families to keep loaded firearms handy. If they don't, they could get a $10 fine. To be fair, the new ordinance says that people with mental disabilities or who can't afford weapons or who are legitimate conscientious objectors don't have to obey. Said Councilman John Brewer, quote, "This is simply using the Second Amendment of the U.S. Constitution to the city of Geauda Springs' advantage." I don't know, it strikes me as a little strange to call a place with a population of 210 a city. By that criteria, a Broadway theater is a sprawling metropolis, and the local shopping mall is a freaking continent. And when asked about the vote, one resident told the Associated Press, quote, "It's nobody's business but our own. Everybody out of town is making this their business. Now go away before I launch this ICBM at your minivan." Awful story from Brooklyn, reported by Newsday. A homeless man was hidden from view as he tried to keep warm under the Brooklyn-Queens Expressway. Well, he was killed early Friday when sanitation workers removing garbage inadvertently scooped him up and crushed him. The man was apparently hard to see because he was wrapped in blankets and garbage bags, and he was sleeping in a pile of plastic bread crates. The good news, not only will his remains be returned to his family, but they'll also get to keep their 5-cent deposit. A ghastly story from Bangladesh last week, where a woman was found dead, her body half swallowed by a snake. She was apparently collecting fruit in the forest when she was attacked, killed, and swallowed up to her waist. It's the first case of an Indian woman being eaten by a python since John Cleese toured Calcutta in 1973. In local entertainment news, guess what holiday gift Long Island Cablevision has in store for its customers? Better quality? More selection? No, a rate hike. Cablevision just announced it will raise its prices for basic family service by 3% early in 2004. Cable blames the increase on programming costs. The networks blame cable companies for asking subscribers to pick up the tab for upgrades, internet access, and specialty services. I'm not sure whom to believe, but I've bashed cable a lot on this show. I think their rates are astronomical, considering what you actually get for the money. But fair is fair. Let's let Charles Dolan and company have their say. So, We're going to run a public service message from Cablevision. They're playing it on one of their channels to help explain the upcoming increase. Runs about 8 minutes or so, so I assume they state their case and really try to prove their point. So let's give it a listen on Dave's Gone By on AM 1240 WGBB Freeport and AM 1240 WGBB.com. Here is a message from Cablevision. At Wrong Island Cablevision, our goal is to give you the best service possible, the widest selection of programming in a format tailored to your needs. We know that some of our customers have expressed concern over the recent adjustment of prices for service and equipment. We wanted to address these concerns by reminding you that Cablevision remains an excellent value. With 80 channels currently on your cable box, most customers pay less than $1.50 a month per channel, with reception far better than those clumsy old rabbit ears. And if you think the Cablevision lineup lacks variety, we'd like to answer that by taking a channel-by-channel stroll across the dial, including some of the new options coming to cable within the year. For example, channels 2, 4, and 7 are still the three major networks, and you get Fox, UPN, and WB11. Yes, before cable they were free, but now they're in color. Channel 6 brings you the movies of Home Box Office and such original programming as Sex and the City and The Sopranos. Under the new schedule terms, HBO is no longer a part of basic cable or the Optimum plan, but you can purchase a $25 gold plan, which entitles you to get Home Box Office, Home Box Office 2, and Home Box Office 3, which shows the same movies as Home Box Office 2 only 5 minutes later. So, if you miss the start of a movie by 5 minutes, you can catch it from the beginning. For a small additional surcharge, you have the option of adding HBO 4, which shows the same movies as HBO 2 and HBO 3 only 10 minutes later and in letterbox format. Cablevision will continue to carry such news and public affairs outlets as the Financial News Network, CNN, Fox, and the brand new FNN, the fictional news network, which will be devoted to White House press conferences. Of course, we're keeping the Weather Channel, and you'll be happy to know we're expanding its range to include animated graphics for patchy fog, dew points, and snain. To help close Cablevision's budget gap, cost-cutting measures have been instituted at News 12 Long Island. They'll still offer the same great local news, but for a smaller geographic area. Specifically, Sunrise Highway between Rockville Center and Baldwin, but not counting North Rockville Center or Eastern Baldwin. Also, the female newscasters on News 12 will now look less like Billy Joel's ex-girlfriend and more like Billy Joel. Public television stations WNET and Long Island's WLIW remain on the dial, though to cover cuts in grant funding, Sesame Street will now not only be brought to you by the letter L and the number 3, but also by the beer Budweiser. We want you to know that despite the belt tightening at Cablevision, we're committed to making the unreadable daily schedules on Channel 14 even more complex. Channel 17 will continue to carry metro traffic for our tens or perhaps dozens of viewers who have televisions in their cars. The very popular Discovery Channel and Food Network will merge into one channel, in which celebrities find and admire rare species and then eat them. Nostalgia buffs can still get their fix on TV Land, Nickelodeon, and the Game Show Network, and be sure to look for the brand new Test Patterns channel. We bring back old favorites such as the wacky rainbow color bars, the American flag, and my favorite, the Indian Chief. MTV will continue to offer its mix of videos and original programming, including the new reality series, Love That Ronnie. Laugh with former President Ronald Reagan as 36 cameras capture his daily foibles such as diaper time and trying to associate that brownish-gray crust on his chin with the word oatmeal. The History Channel will officially change its name to the Hitler Channel and broadcast its latest find, the only three-dimensional color footage of the Third Reich, including Dr. Joseph Mengele looming in and out of focus with a speculum. Long Island's growing Spanish community will now get a fourth channel, Dublé HBO, which translates all the movies on HBO 7 into Castilian and starts them 3 minutes later than the same movies on HBO 6 that are translated into Esperanto. IFC, the independent film channel, will remain a commercial-free home for quality movies out of the mainstream for discerning audiences. Please be assured that Cablevision will keep trying to change all that to make the station more viewer-friendly. We have added IFC 2, which kicks off in January with a month-long documentary festival. The movie Crumb will be shown over and 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 over again. Speaking of which, if you're a Saturday Night Live fan, and who isn't, you'll be happy to know that rebroadcasts of SNL will now not only be seen on NBC, Comedy Central, and E!, but also TV Land, FX, A&E, and Spike. Sketches written by women will be used as fillers on the Lifetime and WE channels. Sketches featuring Garrett Morris, Eddie Murphy, and Chris Rock will appear on Black Entertainment. And the Louise Lasser episode from 1975 will be shown on the Sci-Fi channel. Bowing to legal pressure to include all of the Americas in its programming, the American Movie Channel will now show Canadian movies, as well as Mexican wrestling films, and two reelers starring that south-of-the-border cut-up, Cantinflas. To gain a wider audience, the American Movie Channel has also changed the definition of the phrase old movies to mean any film made before 2000, but after 1993. Public access will be cut back to make room for the brand new Cablevision Shopping Network, in which viewers bid on which movies they'll get to see on pay-per-view a month later. There will be 8 new pay-per-view channels and 3 more home shopping channels, all with picture-in-picture so they can be watched simultaneously. FCC laws forbid us from doing away with public access entirely, so there will still be some homegrown local programming on Channel 71 between 3 a.m. and 4:30 a.m. every third Sunday except in July. And, to demonstrate Cablevision's openness to criticism and viewer comments, public access host Glendora will be getting her own variety show featuring corny jokes, monologues, and those oh-so-nutty legal transcripts. Speaking of the FCC, the government also forbids Cablevision from airing hardcore pornography, so Playboy and the Spice Channel will still refrain from showing erections, penetrations, and ejaculations. However, to compensate, Animal Planet will be adding a new show to its schedule. It's called Let's Watch Animals. Daisy Fuentes hosts and participates. We know that as TV viewers, you have other options besides Cablevision, such as, give me a minute. Oh, satellite dishes, of course. Or you can just put the old aerial on the roof and twist it towards the sun. But we think you'll stay with us despite the recent price alterations, because you know we're constantly trying to improve reception, customer service, and the range of programming. In fact, it's not a deal yet, but we're very close to signing for a second weather channel and a sports channel devoted to elementary school gymnastic competitions from around the world. Wow! Further proof of the superior choice and unparalleled value you get with Cablevision of Wrong Island. We will now repeat this message on Channel 71 over and over and over and over and over and over.
Oh, woe is me. I'm so alone.
Hey, what's the matter you?
I can't meet any decent men. I just know I'm going to die alone.
Oh, now, don't be so negative. There's just as good a chance you'll die with someone else.
How? When?
Well, I don't know. I'm not Bonnie D. Graham.
Who's Bonnie D. Graham?
Well, she's the host of Long Island's Dating, a weekly show for singles, Friday nights at 6 on WGBB. She gives advice, does interviews, takes phone calls, all to help miserable, solitary wretches just like yourself.
When is it on again?
Fridays, 6 p.m. on WGBB, the station that serves your single community. Welcome back to the Dave's Gone By News Gone By on AM 1240 WGBB Freeport and AM 1240 WGBB.com. And where would the News Gone By be without a story or two from the syndicated Weird But True column published locally in the New York Post? This week, I love this one. Chad Allen of Peoria, Illinois, nearly freaked out when he found a dead octopus in his toilet. He thought the creature had flushed up from the sewer system and lodged in his john. What really happened was that Chad's girlfriend had gone to lunch at a Chinese restaurant and noticed a giant boiled octopus on one of the platters. She said, quote, "I've never seen anything like that before, so I thought I'd bring it home as a joke and put it in a jar in the fridge. My friend suggested I put it in the toilet," unquote. The girlfriend was even more disconcerted when she saw what Chad put on her dinner plate. Another weird but true item, the Ticonderoga Pencil Company. Yeah, if you have kids, you know that name very well. The Ticonderoga Pencil Company had an embarrassing public relations gaffe last week. Since children in school are probably their biggest target audience, someone at Ticonderoga had the well-meaning idea to put positive anti-drug messages on their pencils. One of them was, "Too cool to do drugs." All well and good, until children started using and sharpening the pencils, at which point they started to read, "Cool to do drugs," and then just, "Do drugs!" Oh, Lord. I'm just glad they stopped it before they went with their second idea, "Friends don't let friends drive drunk." Speaking of mind-altering substances, I gotta do one more weird but true story. These are just kicking butt. A 13-year-old Vietnamese boy was kidnapped by drug addicts. They stuffed him in a sack and tried to sell him to a restaurant as dog meat for $19. Luckily, the owners noticed the sack was wriggling and screaming and let the boy go. Otherwise, it would have been the first case in history where diners in a Vietnamese restaurant ordered dog and instead were served a different meat. Hard to believe, but back in the days of silent movies, director D.W. Griffith painted the Ku Klux Klan as saviors of the South and the white way of life. Here we are, 90 years later, and this is how the Klan makes the papers. An initiation ceremony in Johnson City, Tennessee, went awry when one of the participants, in a celebratory mood, fired a pistol in the air. The bullet came down on another participant's head, exiting through the bottom of his skull and leaving him in critical condition. The guy who fired the gun, Gregory Allen Freeman, fled the scene but was picked up by cops at his home later on. They say he was easy to spot because he was stumbling all over his yard with his white hood turned around on his head. Asked why he did that, he told police, "Psh, how dumb can you be? So I can see behind my back." Now how's this for synergy? Earlier we did a Woody Allen birthday tribute, and here's a news story proving him not only brilliant, but 30 years ahead of his time. In his classic 1973 comedy Sleeper, about life in an ultra-mechanized society of the future, the Allen character stumbles on this magical orb at a party. Well, as soon as he touches it, he goes into a goofy rapture, as does everyone who gets their hands around this so-called orgasmatron. A lot of filmgoers remember those scenes because they were so zany and ridiculous. Except, here comes Dr. Stuart Malloy of Piedmont Anesthesia and Pain Consultants of North Carolina. He's created a device, an implant, for women with back pain. It's a remote-controlled machine with electrodes that attach to specific nerve bundles on the spine and disrupt pain signals to the brain. All well and good, but when Malloy accidentally put it in a different place on one of his patients, she started to moan and said, "You have to teach my husband to do that." Now, the stimulator is undergoing a clinical trial for women with orgasmic dysfunction, and if tests go well, the gizmo, or gasmo, will sell for about $17,000 for a permanent model, $3,000 for a temporary. Women who volunteer for the testing process can try the gadget for free. So if you're interested, not a joke, call Piedmont Consultants at 336-718-4002. Area code 336-718-4002, just giving that number out as a public service, and call soon, because while there are many available positions, it is first served, first come. And that's the news gone by for December 1st, 2003. Please send your comments, opinions, and orgasmatrons to Dave's Gone By, P.O. Box 62, Hewlett, New York, 11557-0062. Make sure you use a Ticonderoga No. 2 pencil and send those responses to Dave's Gone By, Box 62, Hewlett, New York, 11557-0062. Remember, we don't take off points for wrong answers, but the right ones can get on the air, name withheld upon request. If you don't have a pencil, well, email's okay too. Dave'sGoneBy@AOL.com. Dave'sGoneBy@AOL.com. I say this, and I mean it. Getting feedback and responses from the listeners is one of the things that makes this gig so fulfilling. With your input, there's flow, there's current. Without it, I'm just a dead octopus stuffed in your radio toilet. So flush me out with letters, emails, phone calls, 516-295-1511. Send me cards, send me checks, send me holiday gifts and doorbells ringing, but please, no dog meat. I've already got kennel cough. Back after this. Welcome back to Dave's Gone By, a little segment we like to do called Dave's Gone Cultural. That's where we look at what's playing in the movies or theaters or in books or music. Usually it's the theater, because that's where I generally hang my hat as a critic. And I've been remiss the past few weeks in doing reviews on this program. Haven't done a lot of them. Been seeing lots and lots of shows, just haven't had the time on here to talk about them. October and November were the big months of the fall season, and Broadway had a huge crop this year. I'm not even dealing with off-Broadway, just Broadway seemed to be opening two or three shows a week, which made for a lot of quantity, if not always quality. You've probably heard or read other critics bitching that it's been kind of a blah theater season so far. They're certainly not griping about the amount of shows, or even that there hasn't been good work and things to be excited about, but they've had trouble finding a show that, overall, is a winner from start to finish. Now, I haven't seen The Boy from Oz, but by most accounts, Hugh Jackman is worth seeing, and the rest of it, eh. I haven't seen Wicked, but that's proved to be a real love-it-or-hate-it piece. I have seen Taboo, the Boy George musical, and while the music is often pretty catchy, the book tries to pull together two different stories into one, and it really doesn't do justice to either. Now, a couple of flops came and went pretty quickly. I didn't get to see either of them, or in the case of Six Dance Lessons in 6 Weeks and the Jackie Mason Show, I did. Lucky me. Now, I loved Golda's Balcony. It's a terrific one-woman show with Tova Feldshuh playing Golda Meir, but the New York Times didn't like it, and some other critics think it's more an acting showcase than a full play. Anna in the Tropics won the Pulitzer Prize, and it's a good play, but kind of predictable and a little flat in the staging on Broadway. So, as I said, critics were simply grousing that they couldn't find that one big new Broadway show everyone agreed was a hit. Well, they found it on November 23rd with the opening of Wonderful Town, a revival of a classic musical by Betty Comden and Adolph Green, music by Leonard Bernstein, at the Al Hirschfeld Theater. By the way, that's the new name of the Martin Beck Theater. This summer they renamed it after the famous caricaturist 6 months after he died. I think they planned the name change while Hirschfeld was still alive, but he didn't quite make it to his 100th birthday in 2003. Anyhow, I hope to spend more time on some of the other shows I mentioned on upcoming segments of Dave's Gone Cultural, but I really couldn't wait to talk about Wonderful Town. And no, this is not a commercial, though for the most part it's going to sound like one. Maybe I'm jumping on the bandwagon here, but Wonderful Town is a wonderful show, and I am as surprised as anyone, because first of all, Comden and Green have been pretty bad news on Broadway for a few years now. They had the revival of On the Town that was directed by George C. Wolfe, and that was all over the place and very overheated. Then you had Faith Prince in Bells Are Ringing, and it was kind of sweet, but underheated, undercooked. And I had seen Wonderful Town, gosh, almost a decade ago, I guess, not very memorably, at City Opera with Krista Moore and Kay McClelland. So, you know, when this production was announced and was done at Encores just about 3 years ago, I was like, okay, and then the reviews came out and was like, oh, it's really special, and it was supposed to come to Broadway right then, but you know how these things are with scheduling difficulties and cast members not finding the right theater, and suddenly it was off the schedule, then back on, then back off for last couple of years. But and by the time it has made it now to Broadway, most of that Encores cast didn't come with it. But thank goodness Donna Murphy did. And that's all you really need to know. You'll see her picture on my website, hometown.aol.com/Dave's Gone By. Now, you know, I've been following Murphy, we all have, since she was off Broadway in Song of Singapore. Then she did that boring Stephen Sondheim show Passion, and that terrific King and I revival for which she won a Tony. But here, it's the comedy again that wins out, a range of her personality and her talent that we haven't seen since Song of Singapore. And she has a way with a quip, that is for sure. She's not doing Rosalind Russell, but you'll hear echoes of her when she uses that low register voice. And just when you wonder if Murphy's going to be just a brassy frump for the show, she turns like totally sexy and fun in the conga number. She is the reason to see this revival of Wonderful Town. But she's not the only reason. You've got Jennifer Westfeldt. That name sounds familiar. That's because she directed and co-starred that indie hit Kissing Jessica Stein. And totally different person, I imagine, in this show than from that movie, which I have not seen. Also, some nice work from Michael McGrath, who's been doing some terrific character work, funny character work on Broadway for years now. He plays a newspaper man with eyes for the pretty Colleen Eileen. You've got Greg Adelman as an amiable, low-key book editor. You know, he plays the character more Jeff Daniels than John Raitt. And my only real complaint was David Margulies plays a character called a populist, like the landlord, and he's a bit over the top. You hear the band wonderfully. They're visible behind a screen. That should be a distraction, but you do forget about them, and it's wonderful to hear a full Broadway orchestra playing some pretty terrific music. We heard a bit of the overture from the original 1953 cast recording at the top of the segment, and I would stack the singing on the revival up against that of the original, and I certainly hope they do a cast album. I don't think the score itself is deathless, but for a lively musical comedy, it's half archetype, half prototype, and has half a dozen numbers that make you go, oh, that's where that came from. So we will close this segment with Sidney Chaplin and Jacqueline McKeever from the original cast doing the song It's Love, but not before I remind you that Wonderful Town is playing at the Al Hirschfeld Theater on West 45th Street, and apparently ticket sales could use a boost, despite the great reviews. So consider this my own personal boost. It is a good show. You come out feeling happy and really happy that you got to see Donna Murphy in her prime, just a few minutes of her doing classic shtick, and it's love.
It's love. It's love.
Come on now, let's drop it.
It's love, and nothing can stop it.
You're a silly girl, it's a sign of youth.
You're a silly boy, you're in love with food.
Sidney Chaplin, Jacqueline McKeever from the original cast album of Wonderful Town. Here's hoping the revival will also get a cast recording, and here's hoping you enjoyed all the music and comedy and talk on this edition of Dave's Gone By, which, alas, we have to wrap up in a couple of minutes. But before I do, I just want to dip in our mailbag. I think I should have some mailbag noise. Hold on. There we go. As promised, you write in, and when there's time, we try and read what you're saying, especially when it's fawning and complimentary and full of the adoration I so richly deserve. And what do you know? I got two rave reviews about the show last week. Okay, one was from my dad, but the other was from Piero of Gibson. He had written in 2 weeks ago to compliment my Art Carney impersonation. After last week's Thanksgiving episode, he again emailed me to say, quote, that's a funny show. Thank you, Piero. Thank you a lot. Unfortunately, the first part of that sentence read, boy, I really like Law & Order Special Victims Unit. But hey, I'll take what I can get. also in the mailbag. Something from Chris, emailing from New Jersey. Chris writes, "You look exactly like Matthew Broderick in that new picture on your website, the one that has the older me under it. What happened?" And Chris writes this using not one question mark, but two. What happened? Well, Chris, what happened is that Matthew Broderick went on from small roles in films and theater to be a big movie actor and a Broadway star in The Producers. Meanwhile, I'm on a 1,000-watt radio station in Babylon, Long Island, and living off the Yukonuba my dogs don't finish. Matthew Broderick? At this point, I'm lucky I don't look like Norman Fell. No, but Chris, you're not the first person to point out the Matthew Broderick resemblance. Especially when I had more hair and we both had beards, the similarity was often striking, and I heard that from a lot of people. I even gave an autograph once and waved at a few people. Oh, and Sarah Jessica, if you're listening, the real Matthew doesn't like anal. My bad. Oh, folks, send me your letters, comments, and questions. Dave's Gone By at AOL.com. Dave's Gone By at AOL.com. You can also leave me a voicemail at 516-295-1511. That's also the number to call to find out about advertising on the show. You know you want to. 516-295-1511. And if you want to find out about buying cassettes of old shows or getting a copy of my book, it's not too late for Christmas and Hanukkah and Kwanzaa and whatever else, check my website, hometown.aol.com/Dave's Gone By. hometown.aol.com/Dave's Gone By. If you forget the URL, just Google search Dave's Gone By, and you'll find it super quick. Time for a couple of super quick thank yous. As always, engineer Joe Salzone, thank you so much, even though you weren't here today. Feel better, little dude. Oh, man, I heard you on the radio last night, and you sounded like a completely different person. Your voice and your nose and everything, gosh. Do feel better and come back soon. But don't miss his show, Your World with Joe Salzone, Sunday nights at 6, his late-night show Sunday nights at 11, and generally his Monday evening stints on WGBB Tonight, 6 o'clock on Mondays, just before my show, Dave's Gone By. Thank you to Bonnie D. Graham, hostess of Long Island's Dating, a show for singles, Friday nights at 6. Thanks to the press folks at the Pete Sanders Group for help on this week's Dave's Gone Cultural segment. Thank you to the Tandoor Grill, 222 Sunrise Highway in Rockville Center. Lunch, dinner, and a brand new banquet hall. Check out their menu at tandoorgrill.com. Not tandoori, Tandoor Grill. Leave off the last I for Indialicious. Speaking of food, thank you to Mr. and Mrs. Weil for a fine holiday dinner. You know what they made for Thanksgiving dinner? Reservations. No, but it was a nice restaurant, good food, really enjoyable. And thank you to their daughter, my wife, Joyce. Thanksgiving may be over, but I'll never stop being thankful for having her in my life, in my home, and in my heart. And thank all of you for your heartfelt support week after week, and for bringing your radio to this place at this time every Monday night from 6:30 to 8 p.m. Next week, more me, December 8th, with episode 55 in the ongoing saga of Dave's Gone By. Hope you'll be there with me. Until then, don't miss your days going by. This is Dave Lefkowitz. Good night, good times, and gone by.
I will go a merry way and jump the hedges first. Drink the clear, clean water for to quench my thirst. And I will watch the ferry boats and they'll get high. Against the blue ocean, against the morrow sky.